I'm speaking now with Dr. Søren Bak-Jensen, who's going to be telling us about his project at the Workers' Museum. And good morning, and congratulations on your participation and being a laureate at Best in Heritage. And why don't we just get started by you giving us a bit of an overview of your project, the organization, and you know, what the original intentions were behind your project.
Yes, well, thank you very much for having me here. I've really been looking forward to presenting our project on behalf of the Workers' Museum. The Workers' Museum is an independent, state-recognized museum, library, and archive for the engagement with the history of the Danish labor movement and the living and working conditions of working-class people in Denmark over the past 150 years. The collections were begun in the late 19th century, and the museum was formally set up in 1983. And we work on the basis of a mission statement to strengthen the will to an equal and just society through engaging encounters with history. We aim to encourage social engagement by clearly relating historical issues to questions of inequality in the labor market, in democratic participation, and in the access to knowledge and education. And we work from a perspective of making historical material into a resource for the dialogue and reflection that people today can have about the future. And on that basis, we create and co-create and house a number of different exhibitions, temporary exhibitions, educational programs, and events.
Very relevant subject, you know, today, for sure.
Well, the project that we that I'm presenting today is called Clever Hands. It's a project that opened in the summer of 2018, and it started out as and involves a major exhibition and our most ambitious learning program so far. And the project really had two overarching themes or purposes that we wanted to address. And again, while we were working specifically from a historical background, we really wanted to make this about the present and the future. One aim was to provide a historical perspective on an ongoing discussion in Denmark about the need for young people to educate and choose technical educations and vocational training. The need for more people to work in those areas is a question of national importance, and we really wanted to contribute to solving this project by focusing especially on dialogues, especially with young people, on what working in these fields is actually like. Secondly, the project aimed at bringing the museum into closer contact with people with short educational backgrounds. While these white people with shorter educational backgrounds make up the majority of the population, they are relatively rare visitors to museums. And that imbalance in museum use based on educational background is a major issue among cultural institutions in Denmark. And it's one that really threatens to undermine the political legitimacy of public funding in museums. So we wanted to address that issue by trying to create a project that would have a broader appeal in terms of audience. And then as a third and slightly differently angled aim of the project, we wanted to bring the educational activities of the Workers' Museum to a new level. For the past 10 years, we have been we worked on making learning and an educational approach central to the way that we engage with our visitors at the museum. We believe that a pedagogical approach provides us with a knowledge-based entry point into a greater understanding of the people that we are communicating with and that we are trying to reach through our activities. And in Clever Hands, we are going to make this pedagogical approach and the focus on learning and education into the central starting point for a major project at the museum.
Excellent. Just curious, did you notice a difference in your visitation based on this methodology of sort of community engagement and that sort of approach to sort of democratize the approach to the development?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, but that has been one of the great rewards of the project. Yes, it's also been the major challenge that we faced by making this project. Right. I mean, for once, the major challenge of doing this a project was not funding. It wasn't money. We had very, very good response from private foundations for making this project, and that really speaks to an interest and the support for museums to engage in issues that are of importance to people today and importance to society beyond the immediate sphere of arts and culture. The real challenge that we faced was actually connecting with a new audience. I mean, people with shorter educational backgrounds are not used to going. Many people with shorter educational backgrounds are not used to going to museums. It's not because they can't afford the ticket. It's just not part of the habit. It's not really top of mind. It's not expected to be relevant or a good experience. And trying to even create an interest in being part of this project and using the educational facilities and the exhibition was really the main challenge. And I think we have seen a change in our educational composition, in our audience composition, but it's not a major one. And if you think about how much effort we've put into it, it really speaks to how massive this task is and how focused you need to be if you want to make a real change in the audience that you reach. But I think we've also proved that this is actually possible. You can make connections. You can also make lasting connections with a new audience if you're willing to understand what will be the motivations, what are the issues that should be addressed, and how can you form the experience in a way that will appeal to other people than those who will usually come to your museum. So yes, we have seen a change in the visitors who come to the museum, but we've also seen what a massive task that lies ahead of us, and that's really something that we'll take with us in shaping the strategic future of the Workers Museum.
Were there any concerns leading in around the idea of the museum, say, giving up its curatorial authority or its perspective in order to have this like sort of co-creation and community curatorial sort of angle to everything?
I think we made that journey a few years back, actually, saying, well, we need to let go of the control, and we need to think about not what we need to say and what is really important for us to say, but what is very important for the people that are using us to hear and to meet. So I think we actually had that process a couple of years back. Still, it is really, especially working with new audiences, I mean, it's really an eye-opening experience, and also one that can make you want to hold back a little bit. From very early on in this project, and I think this was something that was important for the jury of the DASA Award in their election of the Workers' Museum as a prize winner. From very early in the project, we involved young people about to make their educational choice, or people already working as craftsmen, in the conceptualization of the whole project, of the idea behind the exhibition, of the composition of the educational activities. And we had some really, really thought-provoking insights there. I mean, a statement like, try to hide the fact that you're a museum is something that has really stuck in my mind, at least. And also listening to young people saying, well, we do not want another enlistment campaign for technical schools. We do not want, you know, being told how happy and good everything is. We want to make people who actually made that choice and talk, have a chance to have a dialogue about what is good, what is bad, what are their thoughts about the choices that they have made. And that really, that ended up shaping the whole project and the way it's made. And I think there's a lot of understanding in the organization that this is a way that we need to work. It's not just a way of making things more relevant for our audiences. It's also a way, a necessary way for us to improve as an organization, to improve as individual museum workers, in trying to understand what are the challenges we face, what are the things that we need to understand in order to reach a broader audience. So I think there is a very good understanding of that. And of course, receiving the kind of international professional recognition through the DASA Award and through being invited to be part of the Best in Heritage Conference, of course, that only strengthens the knowledge and understanding that we're actually moving in the right direction.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, if museums want to retain that trust relationship with their audience and maintain that position of being the most trusted knowledge institutions globally, then it's through the adaptation and evolution of core museum practices like this that will allow that trust relationship to evolve and to maintain. And so I think it's brilliant. I had to do a lot of work like that at the Canadian Museum for Human Rights. Was always working with community groups and stakeholder groups as active participants. And I think it's really interesting this time now as museums pivot to you know, not be like to have that position of trust and to imagine and think about what that means in order to evolve and maintain that position within, you know, civil society and civil discourse. I think is really, really interesting, and it's really excellent to hear about your project and how it's amazing. Just curious about the collections, when you had sort of like the apprentices bringing pieces in, like how did that affect your collections mandate? Were you accessioning things or being the stewards of pieces within a community collection, or how was that sort of impacted when we get into the tangible sort of aspects of collecting and
exhibiting the apprentices pieces were really an amazing part of the whole project. These were not they were not accessioned into the collection. They were loans from the newly trained craftsmen who had made them. But they played an important part in the exhibition, and also in the events program. The young people who have completed their education presented the apprenticeship pieces in the historical setting of the exhibition. It was really, really quite remarkable events. And it really underlined something very basic about museum practices, that the materiality can form connections between people and can make relations between people today and past histories very tangible and very emotional, actually. So I think what you're saying about the willingness to transform as a museum, I think that's really, really important. But it's also really encouraging to see how that we can actually transform by employing some of the very, very basic things that we are set up to do. For example, to collect and preserve the past for future generations. In connection with this project, we have changed our accession policy in the way that we are spending much more time in documenting and collecting from present day events like demonstrations or workplaces. Documenting individual stories from people who work in the areas that we work with, and it's obvious that creates a sense of ownership, a sense of relationship, with the museum that I think can have long-lasting effects. So it's really by being a museum that we can change ourselves, and I think there's a lot of support or hope in that. So that we can actually use our core functions in the transformation that we need to do.
Excellent. Well, thank you for the opportunity to dialogue about your project. Congratulations. It's definitely very relevant to me in a lot of the work that I've pursued, particularly in terms of social justice and human rights and community engagement. I think, you know, like I said, this is a very important time, I think, for museums, and your project really, you know, sort of epitomizes the pivot that museums are looking to make and being successful. And it's a great demonstration of how you can achieve that success. So congratulations again. It was really nice speaking with you, and hopefully this won't be the last time. Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you a lot. Thank you very, very much for your time, Corey, and hope to see you here in Copenhagen sometime.